Our planet is surrounded by a thin layer called the atmosphere that contains the air we breathe and is itself divided into sublayers. It is a mixture of gases and particles which gradually fade away into space. Based on temperature inversions, four layers can be defined within the Earth's atmosphere. At the bottom, the troposphere is the most dense and extends up to about 10 kilometers. The global average temperature at the surface is around 15 degrees C, then decreases linearly to reach about minus 50 degrees C at the tropopause. Above starts the stratosphere, which in its lower part shows an almost constant temperature around minus 50 before it rises again near 0 degrees C at the stratopause. This phenomenon is due to the presence of the ozone layer between 20 and 30 kilometers, which absorbs most of the UV solar radiation and warms up the stratosphere. This temperature inversion also leads to little vertical mixing and convection in this layer. The mesosphere temperatures decrease with increasing height, somewhere around minus 100 degrees at about 85 kilometers. It is a not well-known region of the atmosphere due to the lack of instruments capable of reaching these altitudes except for occasional and brief rocket flights. Finally, only residual constituents are found in the thermosphere, where temperatures can increase up to 2,000 degrees during the day because of the absorption of highly energetic solar radiation and go down well below zero at night. In this course, we will focus on the lower part of the atmosphere, that is to say, the troposphere. So let's have a closer look. The air we breathe is mainly a mixture of 78% of nitrogen, 21% of oxygen, and 0.9% of argon. It accounts for 75 to 80% of the total mass of the atmosphere. The remaining 0.1% corresponds to other inactive noble gases, as well as gaseous and particulate species that play a very important role in atmospheric processes and air quality despite their trace concentrations. Water vapor, carbon dioxide, methane, ozone, or nitrogen oxides, to name a few, along with aerosols, are some of the tropospheric constituents that have a major impact on our environment and life. Some of these substances present in trace amounts in our environment can have adverse effects either on human health, vegetation, material, or climate. That's the reason why they are called air pollutants. When they reach harmful levels, the phenomenon is known as air pollution. The specific impacts of pollutants will be detailed in the next 2 weeks, as well as the way they affect our lives and societies. Tackling air pollution in indoor or outdoor environments requires to develop air quality standards that will set up thresholds for the emission and/or concentration levels of the unhealthiest pollutants. These regulations are generally enforced at the national level with the primary objective of reducing air pollution impacts. Additional objectives may include testing the implementation of effective reduction strategies or communicating information about air quality or emission levels to the public. Whatever the environment, indoor or outdoor, a wide variety of sources can emit pollutants directly into the air. These are therefore classified as primary pollutants. On the contrary, secondary pollutants arise from transformation processes of chemical species occurring in the ambient air. A second distinction can be made, depending on their origins, between natural sources and anthropogenic sources, that is to say, resulting from human causes. You will have the opportunity to find out more about emission sources by completing this week's activity. Once in the air, pollutants can be further transformed and transported according to various processes strongly dependent on environmental conditions, especially weather. After some time, they will be removed from the atmosphere either under dry or wet conditions. Dry deposition refers to the impaction of the pollutant onto a surface. Wet deposition indicates that the pollutant has been in contact with some aqueous medium, which can include dissolution in droplets, incorporation in clouds followed by precipitation, or collision with water drops that will wash them out of the air. To summarize, the pollutant cycle consists mainly of these steps: emission, transformation and transport, deposition. The length of this cycle can be represented by the residence time or atmospheric lifetime for a given pollutant, which tells us how long a chemical species has spent on average in the air. All of these steps can be put into equations and simulated numerically using complex chemistry and transport models adapted to indoor or outdoor environments. These models are furthermore validated using measurements or observations carried out in the field.